Let's go over the rules for taking derivatives of products of vectors. So let's suppose that we've got a scalar function f of t, and we've got a couple of vector functions, u of t and v of t. So we want to know how to take the derivative of a multiple of u of t, the dot product of u and v, and the cross product of u and v. And the answers are pretty straightforward. It looks just like the ordinary product rule. You take the derivative of the first times the second, plus the first times the derivative of the second. And that works when f is a scalar and u is a vector. And it works when u and v are vectors that you take in the dot product. And it works when u and v are vectors that you're taking the cross product. It's always derivative of the first times the second, plus the first times the derivative of the second. And where times just means multiplication, or dot product, or cross product, whatever the setting. Now the tricky thing is to remember to keep the order of the vectors. When you're doing the product rule for scalars, you often say the derivative of u times v is u times the derivative of v plus v times the derivative of u. You never want to write v times the derivative of u here. It's the derivative of u times v. U times the derivative of the v. The u comes first, the v comes second, because in the original product, the u came first and the v came second. Cross products depend on which order you put things in, so you got to be careful about that. Finally, the chain rule works exactly as it does for scalars. The derivative of u of f of t, you take u prime of f of t times the derivative of what's inside. Now, to see why these rules work, we just do our calculations one variable at a time, like we do almost everything one variable at a time. So for example, if you had the function f of t u of t, well, that's f of t u1 times I plus f of t u2 times j plus f of t u3 times k. And if we take the derivative of each of those, all we do is we take the derivative of f of t u1, we use the regular product rule on this, and the regular product rule on this, and the regular product rule on this, and we collect terms, and we're done. You want the dot product? Well, the dot product is this product plus this product plus this product, and these are just scalar functions. You apply the regular chain product rule to each of those, collect terms, you're done. Cross product? Well, you got a six terms. But for each of these, you can apply the regular product rule, and you're done. So now that we've got these rules, let's apply them and learn a little bit of physics. So in physics, you're often interested in the momentum of a particle. The momentum is the mass times the velocity, or the mass times the derivative of the position. Now that's a vector, because the velocity is a vector. The angular momentum is a cross product. It's r cross the regular momentum. Or you can pull out a factor of m and you say it's m times the cross product of the position and the velocity. And it's usually denoted L, and the regular momentum is usually denoted p. Don't ask me why. And then we have our force. Force is mass times acceleration. So that's the mass times the derivative of the velocity. And that's the derivative of momentum. So the way you change something's momentum is you apply a force to it. So let's figure out what the derivative of the angular momentum is. The angular momentum is r cross v times m. The m is a constant, comes along for the ride. We have two terms. We have dr dt cross v plus r cross dv dt. But dr dt, that's just v. And v cross v is zero. V and v are pointing in the same direction, any vector crossed with itself is zero. So we're left with mr cross derivative of v. But the derivative of v is the acceleration. And mass times acceleration is force. So we get r cross the force. And that's called the torque. So for ordinary momentum, we change the ordinary momentum by applying a force. The derivative of the momentum is the force. The derivative of the angular momentum is the torque. We change the angular momentum by applying a torque. Okay, let's work a problem. Let's suppose that somebody gives us these two vector-valued functions. U is sine of t cosine of t, t, and v of cosine of t minus sine of t 1. And you'll notice that v is the derivative of u. And somebody says, hey, consider the function, their dot product and their cross product. Take the derivatives of each of them. So the first thing we want to do is we want to take the derivatives of u and the derivative of v. We've already got the derivative of u. Derivative of u is the same thing as v. And the derivative of v, well, derivative of cosine is negative sine. Derivative of negative sine is cosine. Derivative of 1 is 0. And there we go. We've got our derivatives. And now we can go ahead and start to work out our dot products. So to take the derivative of u dot v, it's u prime dot v plus u dot v prime. And we know what u prime is. We know what v is. We know what u is. We know what v prime is. And then we just multiply things out. Cosine times cosine, that's cosine squared. Sine times sine, that's sine squared. Minus sine times minus sine, that's sine squared. 1 times 1 is 1. And then we have minus sine squared minus cosine squared. So we wind up with this whole expression. The cosine squareds cancel, the sine squareds cancel, and it all boils down to 1. The derivative of f is 1. What about the derivative of r? Well, we take u prime cross v plus u cross v prime, and that gives us a couple of big cross products. Well, the first cross product, this is 0, because it's a cross product of vector with itself. This term, well, how do we work out a cross product? We write out our extra two rows. Sine t, cosine t, minus sine t, minus cosine t. And then we do our crisscross. We do, this gives you 0. This gives you minus t sine t j. This gives you minus sine t cosine t k. Those we take up. And then we take minus what happens in this direction. So we get plus sine of t cosine of t k. Plus t cosine of t I, and we put it all together, and we get, in the I direction, we get t cosine of t. In the j direction, we get minus t sine of t. And in the k direction, we get 0. And there's our answer.